So I'm back with another dev blog from Beyond the Wire, and I've only just had a recent one, but they threw another one out, so we're covering it. This time we'll be talking about uniforms, and in the background we're going to show pictures from this dev blog, of course, especially whatever I'm talking about, and then for uniforms we have some trailer footage, because we always have that, and then we got some original art, which was pretty good demonstration of the uniforms as well, so I'm going to be rotating through all of those in the background. Let's see what it's about. So obviously, following on from last week's mechanics, we're talking into Germany entering the war. They're relying on its superiority in heavy artillery, strategic speed and overwhelming firepower. The Germans were pioneers in the use of flamethrowers, chemical weapons, and spent large resources on weapons and high-quality uniforms for soldiers. An excellently designed gas mask and one of the most effective helmets of the first half of the 20th century, which, the helmet, I mean, is obviously iconic. And followed them through into World War II, and a lot of modern helmets were designed off that basis as well, with the German Steinhelm, I believe it's called. Stahlhelm, that's what it is, the Stahlhelm. This first one here is a nice picture of a German soldier in a coat with binoculars and a cap, which I assume this guy is very clearly an officer, just judging from what he's wearing behind at the minute now. I mean, if he's not an officer, I don't really know what he is. I'm just trying to look around him now. And it looks like he might have a pistol to his side, but that's kind of really hard to tell on his left side. But he's got a nice belt, got binoculars. He's looking fashionable, and he's got a nice coat. So I'm pretty sure this is what our German officers are going to look like, or squad leaders, or things like that. Nice little barbed wire in the background there. Nothing too much to say about the background, really, is there? However, carrying on, we're going to read through the text as well. Due to limited human resources, much attention was paid to protecting soldiers, and so the Germans actively used metal cuirasses, sniper shields, and additional armour, brow plates on helmets. So, kind of nice to see the sniper shields there, that they're going to feature in the game. We'll see what happens. Or maybe they might just be sit-down positions. So, for instance, I always try and refer to other games to try and see what it would be like. Battlefield 1, it's an equipment that you can put down wherever you want, within reason. In Verdun, they are already set into the map in the trenches, so they could go either way with this. All in order to save the life of the soldier, all of these things are. However, despite the rapid onslaught and initial success in the war, the German economy was too dependent on external supplies of scarce resources, and so many of its technological advances were not made in sufficient quantities to turn the tide of the war, as the High Command had hoped, with a range of equipment being necessary when heading out beyond the wire. Your unit will be... Oh, when heading out beyond the wire, I was reading that as if it's the title of the game, that's why. Your unit will be equipped to tackle hazardous and obstacles in this trench. And then we got into what I'm assuming is a German standard officer, or a medic, seeing as his helmet has the medic symbol on it. He's got his backpack, drink. Not sure what that is on his right side. That's what would be a smoke grenade, but that's just more like a US modern day smoke grenade. World War II smoke grenade, not back then. He's got his nice gewehr over his shoulder, and he's got a little pile behind him of equipment, which will, I think will probably end up being some kind of like resupply point. That's what that's going to be, but we don't know. That's just me speculating, to be honest. And as you see, back in the day, they never really used to wear body armor because it wasn't really effective enough. And the helmets weren't really designed to stop you from getting killed by a round. I mean, if it was going to scrape your head, it might ricochet, but it's just more for protection from artillery. So when it's here land nearby, it would kick up a load of debris, and the helmet would stop things from landing on your head and killing you, so, or severely injuring you. But inspired by the real counterparts, our diverse loadouts have allowed us to bring unique character models for each squad role. Being able to identify critical teammates such as medics, as we see above, and leaders quickly by assessing their character is a huge bonus, especially when attempting to navigate across the undulating shell craters of No Man's Land. Okay, so not just the uniforms, but we've got their models. So we've got some head models here, showing the out-of-engine character heads they've been working on, which look really nice, by the way. So to make our character models as believable as possible, we have decided to use photo scanning technology for the head and hand models. This speeds up the process significantly, as the photo scan data already includes surface information which we use as a base for our texturing process. We use simulation software to make uniforms and other equipment look more organic, Additional details like folds, rivets, seams, buttons and stitches are sculpted in other 3D software. Yeah, nice to see the technology used here. And then we can see on the hand one as well, how they go from photo scan texture and then the textures on top. Details such as surface wear and tear are added during texturing and painting process. High resolution models and textures are included on the first person view. That makes the soldier's sleeves, hands, weapons sharper to the camera. Given that we're utilizing a fully modular design, all our head models, arms, uniforms, and equipment are possibly interchangeable for added flexibility, which allows for quick iterations. Okay, I like that. So modular means they can make new things better. That's fine. Bonus reading this. High resolution models and textures are included on the first person view. So obviously that means you're going to see yourself better, which means other characters won't look as good as they do on you, but that's good because that will save rendering time as well. But that probably also means that it's not going to be a true first person, it's not going to be true first person view, so it'll be, it's going to be the one where it's your first person camera, actually all you are is a pair of arms and a head. So that means you probably won't see animations on other people perfectly accurately, that's normally how games like that run it. Which is, it's a little bit of a gripe because I just really like it when games do that, when you can see really accurate animations on other people, but I don't mind too much. It doesn't really break immersion, doesn't break the game, it's fine. Lastly, we created a custom skin shader for the hand modules, which adds a sense of softness to the surface, making the skin look more realistic. Yeah. Now we got some equipment uniforms, so the M1916 Stahlhelm, famous German helmet, which has become a main reference for many post-war helmets due to its efficient design, which, yeah, as I said earlier, and they always say about the horns on the side, people always talk about, but yeah, especially like these always get associated with the Nazis, like Nazi Germany. I don't know why that always happens. It was made in World War II, but yeah, but the horns are actually there for invent and attaching other stuff. So the Sternpanzer, which is a front plate to the helmet, which I imagine is then designed to actually try and stop some rounds hitting you. I can't imagine it would stop a 7.62, I can't imagine it would stop a LaBelle round or something like that, but probably stop a pistol round. Well, it might ricochet a LaBelle, it probably won't stop one dead on, I would have thought. That's just my theory of it. But during the Great War, several modifications were released. The Stahlhelm had the same small horns, which were used to attach an additional armoured brow plate. So just reinforced Stahlhelms. Such reinforced Stahlhelms were not very comfortable due to the increased weight. The centre of gravity shifted forward, but snipers, sentries and stormtroopers prefer to endure discomfort for the sake of even a small chance of survival. Which, yeah, you see, so that makes sense for snipers, because obviously you pretty much only got your head shown. But you see that in modern day when you do, like, riot police and things. So, like, if you ever look at the Russian FSB units, you see, like, some of the kit that they wear into things. Like they wear the Alten nowadays, which is an incredibly uncomfortable helmet with a face shield on to wear, but if you get told to go clear a building with people in it with guns, you're going to want to fucking wear it. So it's that kind of mentality, I think. And the other have the 1917, okay, I'm going to try this, Liederschutzmask, that's what I'm going for, gas mask. The Germans were leaders not only in protective equipment, but also in chemical warfare, being the first to use poison gas for military purposes near Ypres. To use chemical weapons, the German army needed reliable respiratory protection, and the German design was excellent, but it was made from rubber, which was expensive to produce, so back then obviously they imported rubber, I think, they didn't have any natural sources. And then the last things are shown is the normal uniform and the uniform with the greatcoat, which is kind of what we saw from the first picture, which is just a comparison between standard infantrymen and the officers. So it's one of the bonuses of being in a leadership position. Officers were issued with more durable equipment and uniform, with a greatcoat made from wool and rubber trench boots. They were protected well against weather and the conditions of prolonged trench warfare. And the rest of the army needed protection from similar hazards, but their German their uniform lacked the same standard. With hard-soled ankle boots and leg strappings known as Gamaschen, protecting against the muddy bog, which the uniform allowed the soldiers to move freely no matter the circumstance, which is like the World War One makeshift version of what you'd call like gaiters nowadays. So yeah, that is what soldiers look like. Obviously the last two aren't textured, but let's just look at the uniforms. Comparing them to the trailer and what we've seen in the art, I mean, they look really nice, and I think they're going to look really nice in game. Not much more to say on it really, is there? It's uniform, and we've seen it. So, excited to see what the next Devblog brings us, and if you are too, feel free to subscribe and I can show you. See you guys later. Have a good one.